It's this huge robot that just goes along rails and takes pictures of plants. I call it the plant robot. And inevitably, the next question that they always ask is, why? Why do you take pictures of plants?
Arizona is described by some as having the climate of tomorrow, today.
If we think about corn, if you want to see how it responds to drought, you need to bring it to an area like this. You know, they don't build Volkswagens in Maricopa, Arizona, but they bring them here to test because it is so extreme.
The crops growing here can do so in upwards of 115 degree heat, often with limited water. So as the world's climate changes, how will farmers grow the crops of the future? These scientists want to figure that out.
Thinking about the future, we need to start planning for it now. Because if we don't, we're going to arrive at a situation in 50 years where we're not equipped to deal with it. Basically, it'll change the way we live.
Does it get harder to kill them off, I'm assuming, when they go deeper in at that point?
Second round of treatment.
According to researchers, this is the largest agricultural robot in the world. It's collecting data from crops here in Maricopa as part of a collaborative effort between research institutions to better understand plant genetics and plant responses to the environment. A team of scientists and engineers from the University of Arizona manage the day-to-day operations of the Field SCanalyzer and help process the data it collects. The project has been running since 2016, with funding from the Department of Energy and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. The project aims to help produce stress-resilient crops, ones that could thrive in warmer and drier climates, or help produce biofuels to reduce reliance on fossil fuels.
Specifically like these ones, we're getting some extensive feeding damage. The climate models predict that, 100 years surface temperature will be increased by 5 degrees centigrade. That's a lot different than what we have now. And we aren't going to be able to develop plants fast enough to meet that change in the environment.
Scientists are still trying to figure out how likely that is. But Paulai and his team are hoping to produce plants that can withstand the warmer temperatures forecast by several climate models.
The long-term goal is understanding, how we're going to address this problem of understanding drought resiliency. You'll notice it has this large bank of LED lights. How this camera operates is it basically sends out a saturating pulse of light that quenches all the photosystems within the plant, and then we take a series of about 100 images in about 2 seconds.
The 30-ton scanner, referred to by the team as the Gantry, uses sensors and cameras to capture detailed images of the width, length, shape, and angle of individual plant leaves. A single scan can generate more than 15,000 individual photos.
The information that we can gain from the Gantry is we can try to see which of these varieties behind me is most efficient with sunlight. Which one's best at taking that natural energy and converting it into biomass. That's what we really want. We want to identify those plants that can do that with the least amount of water possible. And so those are the types of transformative insights that we're really looking for in terms of addressing some of these larger problems.
Paulai hopes that the data collected from the Gantry will be transferable, not just to other crops, but to other localities.
The technology driving this project is really not anything special, but it's more about the integration of all these various different components. What I hope it'll enable, sustainable farming, sustainable production of nutritious calories for people. I mean, that's the goal of this whole project is, improving the human condition.
Another crucial part of the project happens 2 hours away in Tucson.
Yeah, this is where
this one was at the edge.
Eric Lyons leads a team of students who grapple with the thousands of images that come off the Gantry on a daily basis, creating up to 10 terabytes of data per day.
Once we have those coordinates, we can then go back to our 3D images and say, okay, I want a crop of this specific area. And that's what you're seeing here.
One of the key challenges, especially with data coming off the Gantry system, is we're dealing with sensor data from about half a dozen different cameras, as well as a bunch of environmental sensors. So we take all of these data in, all coming from different cameras, all requiring different kinds of data processing.
Part of that processing involves machine learning. Lyons' team is dealing with thousands of images on a daily basis. Machine learning algorithms help them stitch these photos together, as well as identify individual plants and track their progress over time.
Ideally, we'd love to have predictive models. Often these are going to be based on machine learning methods, in order to say, before we plant a plant, how is this going to perform given some scenario over its growing season? How will it perform in a storm? How will it perform in a drought? How will it perform with excessive heat days? How will it perform if it's particularly cold and damp?
While algorithms are making the job of processing this data easier, the project still requires a human touch.
That was the case.
Emmanuel Gonzalez is a grad student at the University of Arizona. He splits his time between the computational side of the project in Tucson and working with the crops in Maricopa.
It's really important to have an exposure to both. There's the whole computational aspect, but there's also spending time with the plants. There's a sense of other information that you get just from being here. The smaller details, such as, you know, how close are the plants, how do they feel? My hope is that as a breeder in the future, I can collect data that can inform growers into growing their crops more sustainably. And what that would hopefully translate into is also making this technology available widespread, not just to farmers here in the United States, but also casting a wider net, right, throughout the world. My family grew up in Mexico, right, and we have very similar weather. I don't really like to focus in on one thing. I always like to see things from a global perspective.
So this is 30 days out from flowering. So basically right now our biggest risk is like ensuring that we get the plants actually flower. And so any type of this type of damage just begins to like accumulate.
It's still early days, but the team here hoped that this data could help the farmers of the future grow successful crops in what could be increasingly challenging conditions.
If we do our job well, the gantry will be obsolete. And I say that not from like anything jaded, it's just the fact that that means that we've been able to take the technology, the instrumentation, we've been able to like make it small. Democratization, basically. How do we take like some of the cameras on board, make them small, and put them in the pockets of, you know, subsistence farmers, or any farmer really, to basically improve crop production?
I think in the future, farmers are going to rely increasingly more on technology. I mean, at the moment, they already do. There are sensors that they mount on tractors, and they have subscriptions to a variety of different geospatial technology out there. And that's just going to increase. I think the farmer of the future is going to not only be able to know how to manage a field and work the plants, but also be able to wrangle the technology and be able to make informed decisions from that.